ahead. So one Kilkenny woman on the line there. We're going to Kilkenny man now, and Tommy Welsh. How are you getting on, Tommy?
Yeah, good on. Looking forward to the Christmas.
Yeah, yeah, same as. So the hurling team of the year, do you go through this and just say to yourself which Limerick man gets into each position, or was it a far more democratic process where there was a lot of other good individual performers outside of the champions?
Yeah, there was plenty of other good performances on, but I think it was dominated by Limerick when the All-Ireland champions win so many matches so convincingly. Like they beat Tipperary, the 2019 All-Ireland champions, beat 6 points and probably looked a lot more comfortable than that back earlier on a couple of weeks ago. And then to go on and win the final, be 11 points, it just shows their domination. The closest match they got was the Galway match. Even though they never looked like losing it, it was still a draw match 70 minutes in. So, listen, they didn't have it all their own way, but my team of the year will be dominated by Limerick men, yes.
Is it Nicky Quaid and goals then? We may as well start off. Who is your goalkeeper?
Yeah, so goalkeeper Nicky Quaid. It was between himself and Socky, Stephen O'Keefe from Watford. I suppose the huge saves that Stephen O'Keefe made in the All-Ireland final put him into contention big time. And, you know, like if Limerick had got the goals at that stage, it could have been an absolute whitewash, because if you score two goals in the space of a couple of minutes, you know, we've seen that happening to Waterford before, and to happen to any team, it's a cruel blow, especially when the team is already a couple of points ahead. But no, Nicky Quaid is the man. I thought he conceded 3 goals on in his first 2 matches, 1 against Clare and 2 against Tipperary. Didn't concede another goal for the remainder of the championship. That tells its own story. The modern goalkeeper is not just about saving the ball. It's about puck outs. It's about leadership, safety. Like, no matter what happens, Nicky Quaid is up for it. In the final, he made a couple of saves, 4 or 5 saves. They were kind of half chances, half goal chances for Waterford. He wasn't diving all around the goal post or anything like that to make these saves. But he was, dude. He was assured. He was, like, the stories are that he turns up an hour before training, 3 nights a week, to get in his goalkeeping moves. And you can see that by his feet. Like, he's always seems to be in the right place at the right time. A goalkeeper, one of the most important thing is that you get your body behind the ball, if you can at all. And that's what he does and did, especially in the final. So Nicky Quaid, for me, has been brilliant for the last couple of years and is probably the leader of that Limerick team.
Yeah, truly deserving of that position. Who's in at cornerback, so Tommy, if we get into the fullback line?
So he's my first nomination for Hurler of the Year as well. He's been absolutely outstanding. He's going for his 3rd All-Star in a row. The cornerback, like, sometimes you put all your best men up the centre. And you will always see with All-Ireland champions, they will have brilliant men up the centre. But cornerback in the modern game, with the quality of ball coming into the full forward line, is exceptional now. You need really good cornerbacks. And if you don't, your year can be short-lived. So Sean Finn, for me, he's been brilliant. He's been consistent. When the ball comes in high or low, he's able to win it. He marks all the top players. And there's no problem to him. He lost his comrades, Richie English and Mike Casey, at the start of the year. You thought this will definitely damage Limerick's chances of maybe convincingly winning this All-Ireland. But no, this man stepped up day after day. So Sean Finn, for me, is the right cornerback.
How much was that you as well, Tommy, trying to actually step up and take the strongest man on the opposition team? Like, I mean, as you mentioned, the injuries were a big thing. I'm not sure how many intercounty hurlers would actually shy away from that, but I'm sure there's sometimes a tendency to say, I'll take an easy day out here, but Finn never seems to be that guy.
Yeah, and maybe the pressure can get to you, because when Rich English and Mike Casey, you know, when they did, I suppose, bow out through injury and that, you wonder, like, the whole country was talking about Sean Finn then. Can Sean Finn keep it together? And sometimes that can maybe, you know, it can probably affect your performances, but it seemed to affect his performances in all the right ways. Like, you know, you talk about the greats of the game back in the full back line, the Mick Kavanaghs, the Ollie Cannings, Jackie Turles, all great men, Paul Murphy in the full back line, but this man is up there with him. He never seems to have a 6 or a 7 out of 10 performance. It's always a 9 out of 10. He asked the question, is it hard to pick up the best men? It is now. Because you go back 10 years ago, 20 years ago, when you got the ball in the back line, it was just struck up. So you just read the game like that. But now the ball is coming in perfect. So you have to be able to not just be out in front of your man, which Sean Finn often is. You have to be able to defend as well. So when your opponent does get the ball, shadow him out, keep him out to the wings. And I suppose, you know, Sean Finn is in that full back line. they didn't concede a goal in the Munster final, All-Ireland semi-final or All-Ireland final. That tells its own story, Owen.
Who's at full-back, Tommy?
Full-back, so who do you put in here, really? Is it Dan Morrissey? Is it Dottie Burke? I've Dottie Burke put in full-back. He's the best full-back in the game. Absolutely outstanding. He's already a legend. In my book, he's there with the Brian Lohans, the Dermot O'Sullivans. Jackie Tyrrell showed on the Sunday game after the All-Ireland final, his catch going backwards. Like, it's only the special players can do that. So he was running backwards and was able to turn in midair and catch the ball towards his own goal. It was an amazing skill and he made it look simple. Last 20 minutes, I felt, when the game was in the balance against Tipperary down in the Gaelic grounds, Dahi Burke, after, you know, he slipped for the first goal that Seamus Callanan got, lesser players would let that affect him and maybe, you know, go on to have a 6 out of 10 performance. He just kept at it and at it. And when it really mattered for Galway in the last 20 minutes, he was the guy that sold it up for that. The time Cathal Barrett got sent off, it was Dottie Burke sold it up from full back to create that chance. And I thought he was just a colossus. He was injured for the Wexford game, but after that, he could be man of the match in every single game.
Right. So we've got Sean Finn, Dottie Burke, two of the three in the full back line. Who's wearing the number 4 jersey in your team?
Yeah, so I'm going to move over Dan Morrissey there. So no, right. I'm not going to leave out Dan. It was between himself and Barry Nash, to be honest. I thought Barry Nash had an outstanding year as well. But no, Dan Morrissey, like, he's from the Hand Club. They've produced such brilliant brothers going back to the 1920s. You have the Mackies, Mick Mackey and John Mackey. You have the Mourns, Ollie Moran, Niall Moran. And now you have the two Morrissey brothers. Like, a Hand can be proud if they've produced greats. Since the early parts of the century. I don't think they had a player on the panel for the 1973 All-Ireland, but they've more than made up for it now. Dan Morrissey came back from the wing-back position, not like from playing in the wing, you have the freedom, play the ball from the front. But when you go back to full-back, you have to be that bit more conservative, Owen. So you can't always play from the front. Yes, maybe 8 or 9 times out of 10 you go for it, but there is that one time where you have to make that decision. No, possibly now it's better let the full forward take the opportunity to score a point than going out in front, taking the risk, and a goal goes in. So I thought Dan Morrissey had a really, really good year. And I think that the younger players do look up to him. He is, while he's still quite young, he's one of the older guys on that team. And I thought his leadership, his strength, and he made a great intervention in the final as well.
Brilliant stuff. So Dan Morrissey is in at corner back there as well. Let's move on to the half-back line then, Tommy. Your own position here. Who have you gone for? We'll start at wing-back, I suppose.
Yeah, we'll start at number 5, Dermot Burns. I'm not sure if he got the All-Star 2 years ago, but definitely deserves one this year. All the talk coming up to the final, Owen, was the aerial ability of Waterford after the, you know, defeat at Kilkenny and Dollar in semi-final. They ruled the skies, they won the air, one of the first battlegrounds that you have to win to become a serious team, to become All-Ireland contenders. First ball came down between Dermot Burns and his Waterford opponent. He caught the ball and you could see, if you go back and look at the video, he knew what it meant. His team knew what it meant, because it meant, I'm not going to be pushed around here today. Waterford, they're not going to rule the skies here today. This is our year. We're going to win 2 All-Irelands in 3 years. Like, I was looking at his scores as well, Owen. He scored 3. This is a wing back now, would you mind? 12 points in total. 3 points versus Clare in the quarterfinal. 3 points versus Tipperary in the Munster semi-final, 2 points in the Munster final, 3 points against Galway in the All-Ireland semi-final, and 1 point in the final. 12 points in total. So, like, you know, that man more than deserves his place on the team.
Yeah, you've made a very, very strong case there. Centre-back then, Tommy?
Centre-back then is Tadhg Dabhorca. You know, arguably the best number 6 in the game right now. You know, his injury after 20 minutes in the final was just cruel. It was absolutely cruel for any neutral GA follower, for any Waterford hurling follower, for any of them people on that Waterford backroom team. They knew what Tadhg did come back from the other cruciate injury. If there was no pandemic this year, he probably would not have made it. He wouldn't have been back in time. Suddenly, in comes COVID-19. Tadhg Dabhorca gets an extra couple of weeks, an extra couple of months to make his comeback, comes back better than ever. That's always the worry you have about the cruciate guys. You know, Roy Keane did his cruciate, Henry Shefflin did his cruciate. You know, so many players have done it. And some of them have come back better than ever. Others haven't. And he's one of the lucky ones. He came back better than ever and was having an outstanding year. And I thought a true mark of Tadhg Dabhurcal was when he went down, you could see the heartbreak in his face, right? Kind of behind, I suppose, his face. You could probably see it in his eyes. And after about 20 seconds, he just jumped up and said, you know what? The 20 minutes gone in the All-Ireland final. This is not about me. This is about Watford trying to get over the line here. I'm going to get up and just show these guys that let's get on with it. Let's bring in a sub and let's get on with it and win this All-Ireland final. He trotted over. And how hard would that have been? And, you know, it was a measure of the man. And, well, I tell you, his performances. What's the best thing about Tadhg Dabhurcal? The skies. When they say Watford win in the skies, you're usually talking about that guy. He can win it going forward. He can win it actually trotting back, which is very difficult to do. So, yeah, Tadhg Dabhurcal, number six.
Brilliant. So, Dabhurcal, number six. Is your team, your All-Star team, playing a sweeper, Tommy?
What do you think?
I think that question doesn't need to be answered. At number seven, then, your other wing-back, Tommy, who's going in here?
Yeah. He was young hurler of the year in 2018. Usually we are looking at where do you pick him in the forward line. Kyle Hayes, 6'4". He gave one of the best first-half performances in an All-Ireland final that I have seen. It's a new way of playing when you're playing wing-back. So the half-forward line now, they tend to go back helping out their defence. So if the wing back kind of stays in his position, yes, he can mop up some ball. But Kyle Hayes went the other way. He said, let's take them on. Let's attack him. And yeah, he went forward. And, you know, it would have been an outstanding goal. One of the great All-Ireland final goals if he happened to bounce that off the ground. Possibly, you know, the chance he got in the All-Ireland final was from playing so much in defence this year. Usually when a forward gets that ball, you know, maybe 10 yards out from goal, he'll bounce the ball off the ground or he'll keep it away from the goalkeepers. His strong side will say that he can save the ball. But no, he hit it and Stephen O'Keefe made a great save. But Kyle Hayes was outstanding all year. And the question mark was, why would you put back one of the best centre forwards in the game, wing back, when he went back against Tipperary? But that just showed how good they're able to adapt. And what he did was as well, he put up a wall outside of that full back line on. As we know, Richie English, Mike Casey, two of the top players in the country missing this year. Two new guys gone back that aren't due. Not just new guys, but guys that aren't used to playing the full back line.
But do you think you would have seen Kyle Hayes back there regardless of the fitness, or was that a reaction to, I guess, Morrissey maybe going back a bit further as a result of the injuries and Kyle Hayes having to fill back then in the half-back line? Was that the reason?
Yeah, I bet me house on it that he went back to it was just unknown, that full back line. You had Barry Nash, right, who wasn't on the team 2 years ago. He's played, you know, I think he was man of the match in an under-21 All-Ireland final corner forward. An outstanding underage player, but couldn't break into the team as a forward. So suddenly last year he was back wing back and had a great campaign. This year then you're asking, a forward to go back corner back. Yeah. It's a huge transition and, you know, deserves huge respect for being able to do that. And Dan Morrissey was tried full back a couple of years ago and, you know, didn't remain there. He would have been when he went out wing back. He was just that strong wing back who didn't let the ball go past him. But I never saw him as a full back. And so this is before kind of, you know, the year really got going. So maybe John Kiely, Paul Kinnerka and co were thinking along those lines. Let's give them as much support as we possibly can. And, it proved very fruitful.
Absolutely. And I mean, that crisis certainly didn't go to waste for them, the injuries in the full back line. They're now in a much better, more versatile position for next year as well. So just to recap where we're at the moment, Nicky Quaid is your goalkeeper, a full back line of Sean Finn, Dahi Burke and Dan Morrissey, and then the half backs are Dermot Burns, Tadhg Dabhurcal and Kyle Hayes. What's your midfield, Tommy?
Midfield then, so we've the Wizard himself out, Keane Lynch, midfield. I know he kind of played between the lines. He was midfield in some games. He was centre-forward in others. But I think, you know, he's the top midfielder in the country at the moment. What I love about Keane Lynch reminds me of Richie Power. He could go on and be the star every day and pop over pints upon pints upon pints. But no, he always picks out the man in the best position. He's not looking for the headlines of a Monday morning in the newspapers or in the Sunday game that night. He's not looking to pick up man in the match awards. He will absolutely blitz you with sublime skill. We've seen on the Sunday game, All-Ireland final night, the top moments of the year, that lovely little flick. If you remember, Keane Lynch did in the middle of the field in a big game earlier on the year. Wonderful. We never see players trying things like that. But he doesn't do it as showboating. He does it as part of the skills that are in his armoury. And yeah, I've great time for this guy. He's probably the only real guy that goes forward with that eye for goal. Most of the guys, when they go past, we'll say midfield, or go past the half-back line on, they will hit the ball over the bar. And that's why you'll often see him scoring 29, 30, 31 points. But when Keane Lynch breaks that line, there's goal on his mind. He set up a great chance for... He nearly scored himself, set up one for Kyle Hayes. The rebound, that would have been a magical goal, you know. He's like the Brazil players in the 70s. Like, he's just wonderful to watch and a wonderful entertainer, but the right way. And with the ultimate respect for his opponents, that double. Then he had another chance where he soloed through. He had a beautiful flick down. It was a hand pass into him out around 40 yards underneath the Cusick stand in the final. And very difficult ball to bring down. He made it look easy. Went in and just the pass didn't work out at the end. I think Ty De Burke came back and intercepted it at the very end. But another goal chance. So Keane Lynch for me anyway, midfield.
Good stuff. So Keane Lynch, one midfielder. Who's in beside him, so?
Yeah, so this one I've gone for Tony Kelly. My other nomination for Hurler of the Year. He scored his 17 points, I see here, against Limerick, the All-Ireland champions. Eight of them from play. Kind of playing between the lines. He's corner forward, centre forward, midfield. He's kind of given a free role, really. And this is in the year that they were missing so many of their marquee players. Peter Duggan missing, John Conlon missing, Colm Galvin missing, Niall Deasy missing. You know, and so many more. So when all their top players, no one, especially I wasn't giving them a prayer, you know, to have any chance in this All-Ireland Championship or to make any impact at all. But Tony Kelly made sure that they did. And he lit up the, it wasn't the summer, he lit up the winter this year, in fairness to him. And I think he earned huge admirers all year round. A small guy, do you know what? And a big shout out to the small guys as well, because, yeah. You know, in the year of Limerick, and they're so, you know, you have two or three guys over 6'4". I think 13 of the team are over 6 foot. And they're saying, is it all about strength? But this is to the young players, the 10-year-olds, the 12-year-olds. You don't have to be big to be one of the top hurlers in the country. You don't have to be big to score 17 points in play. Get out against the wall. Get out and play three on three in your backyard. And get down to the field every day you can. And you can be like Tony Kelly. So fair play to Tony. And yeah, great year.
Yeah, the Messi of hurling?
The Messi of hurling. I wouldn't call him the Messi of hurling. I think he's more, I would say more Ronaldo than Messi.
Right.
Owen, for the simple reason is like Messi just does these magical things that he can basically do anything with the ball. Tony Kelly's more like Ronaldo, where he just spends hours upon hours, I'd say, practicing. So shooting, his shooting is off the charts, especially on that left hand. His running, his fitness, his power, as opposed to, you know, the mind-dazzling skill that Messi brings. Mm-hmm. I'd nearly more compare maybe Keane Lynch to a Messi-type player,
right,
and Tony Kelly to Ronaldo.
So we've got Messi and Ronaldo in midfield. So we've got Keane Lynch at 8, Tony Kelly at 10. What a team.
Not bad. I hope they get on well.
Let's get into the half-forwards then. Who have you gone for?
So wing forward, I think the half-forward line probably speaks for itself and probably picks itself. Garrone Hegarty. My next nomination for Hurler of the Year. I have four nominations actually for Hurler of the Year. So Garrone Hegarty, 7 points from play in the final. He scored... 5 versus Clare in the first game, 4 versus Galway in the All-Ireland semi-final. Brilliant. I think he was the top scorer from play in the All-Ireland Championship. Garrod Hegarty, you know, they say he plays on the edge. I don't think so. I think he plays the way the game should be played. And that's when the ball is there, he goes to win it. And if that's putting in his hurl with the risk of, you know, it could be left in. And, you know, it's just the game moves so fast. I know watching on television, there's so many cameras now. You don't appreciate the speed of this game. You don't appreciate how things change in the split second. I think he's a role model to the way that the game should be played. He gives it absolutely everything. This is a former footballer, would you believe? He mightn't even be playing hurling at the moment. So Garrod Hegarty, I thought, you know, when the game, any game was there to be won for Limerick this year, he was there. And the great, the one thing you'd have to, I suppose, say about him this year is everybody knew what he was going to do. He tips out the midfield, wins the ball, goes up and puts them all over the bar. So it's not as if he was, doing things that people weren't expecting. He was doing the same thing that he's been doing for the last couple of years, and he still couldn't be stopped. That's the sign of the top, top players. So Gerard Hegarty, number 10.
Who's your centre-forward, Tommy?
Centre-forward, TJ Reid. I think TJ this year, before the senior inter-county championship kicked on, we were looking at the club championship, and Ballyhale seemed to be on it quite a bit. And it was a blessing, really, because it gave the viewers more chance to see TJ Reid in club action. We all see him in inter-county action, but even in club action, he was mesmerising. Make the ball talk. He's more your Messi type of player as well. So we've Messi centre forward as well. But outstanding. And I think he's after elevating himself up to the same level as Henry Shefflin, the same level as Eddie Kerr, the same level as DJ in the Kilkenny greats. The question for the last couple of years is, would you put TJ up there? I think there's no doubt about now he's up there. And probably doing it, with not the, the back lines, there's not the same amount of space there anymore, where he can get into these 1v1 situations, which a forward wants. He's able to do it when he's being double marked, triple marked. And I think, he's probably the best guy ever to field the ball in the air. I'm not trying to throw out these. I don't throw out these. I do think about saying these things before coming on air. So I don't throw out these comparisons or these statements, off the top of my head. I truly think, J.J. Delaney to me was the greatest in the air that I remember playing or played with. But I think this guy is now the top man. For the simple reason is he can catch the ball as a forward, much more difficult to do because there's a man behind you and he can play your hurry, play your hand or one. He's still able to catch it. So TJ Reid, number 11.
Right. Is that just hang time? Is it the height of his jump? Is the strength in the air? What constitutes, what are you looking for when you're looking at somebody who's really good in the air?
Yeah, it's timing, it's strength. So to be able to catch it when you're a forward, so your man is behind you. So he's either going to play your hand, play your hurl, he's going to jump in on top of you. So you need to time it to perfection, because if you stand there underneath that ball on, it's easy pickings for the wing back. If you see most of the balls he's catching now, he's nearly jumping. So he's timing that to perfection so that, I can think it was Christy Ring said when he was asked for a tip on catching the ball, you have to catch the ball at its highest point. The reason for it is when you catch it up there, very little chance for a defender to put you off. Mm. You need strength, so you need years in the gym. He is 6'2", so it gives him that advantage to catch it when there's a guy behind him. But it's just an overall brilliance in the air. There's so many aspects to it.
Who's your other wing forward?
Again, a cert for me, Tom Morrissey. Joe Malloy calls himself Gerard Hegarty, the Bash Brothers, and I love it. It is what they are. But they're able to score as well. Looking at his scores, 4 points versus Clare in the first match, 5 in the final versus Waterford, the All-Ireland final, and set up probably 4 or 5 more as well. And he scored 6 in the semi-final against Galway. Tom Morrissey, it all started for me, 2018, All-Ireland quarter-final, Limerick versus Kilkenny. Limerick hadn't beaten Kilkenny in quite some time. I'd say possibly hadn't beaten him maybe since the 73 All-Ireland. And so it was kind of, the big bad, ugly bear Kilkenny there just couldn't get past him. But that day, Richie Hogan scored a goal and it looked like Kilkenny won it, outfox Limerick again, upstepped Tom Morrissey. And he was brilliant in that last couple of minutes. And I think from there on, he's just become, the Tom Morrissey we all know now. He had a quite monster final, was taken off. And you see his interviews before the All-Ireland final, very disappointed, very, very annoyed with himself. Always a sign of the lead players. And came on then, All-Ireland semi-final, All-Ireland final, just magic. Absolutely. To score 6 points and 5 points is unbelievable stuff at that time of the year.
Yeah, ridiculously good. So of the full forward line then, we'll kick this off at number 13, Tommy. Who have you gone for?
13, Aaron Gillan. He is their go-to man inside. I don't think they will be able to play the way they're playing at the moment without Gillan inside and his quality of movement. So Graham Mulcahy, he kind of is given a free role. He kind of goes out around the half-hour line, midfield, full-hour line, given his own little, they trust Graham Mulcahy that he'll make the right decisions. And that's why you'll often see him putting in quality hooks or quantity blocks at the right time. But it leaves Gillan inside with either Seamus Flanagan or or Peter Casey. For the final this year, it was Seamus Flanagan. So in general, Flanagan will be more, get the ball into him. He'll win it with his strength, his first touch, his height. But with Glenn, it's all about movement. And so he's going one way, then he's gone the other. So he has to time it to perfection because he's not the fastest guy in the world. And he has to be out in front of his man. And I thought he was brilliant. He scored, you know, an injury worry coming into the final, a big, big doubt. Their free taker, their talisman. And he scored 4 points, 4 points from play, 10 points in total. And he scored 2-6 against Tipperary, and which was probably the defining game of the season. We look back now at Limerick and we think, you know, they had a handy run through all their games. But that Munster semi-final against Tipperary, you know, it was played in a monsoon. There was a serious wind. And if he hadn't have got those important goals, it could have been a much more different, there could be a much different outcome. And yeah, I would give him huge respect and fair play to him. He's my number 13.
Full forward then, Tommy?
Full forward then is Stephen Bennett. Yeah, again, he was the man in the semi-final against Kilkenny. He set up the goal that won it for him. He scored another goal himself. In the air, he plays much like Gillan, really. He's kind of moving all the time. I thought his leadership as well. Paragon Matney was injured before the first game, went over in a challenge game just before the Munster Championship kicked off, and everyone wrote off Watford's chances straight away because Paragon Matney is always a 10 or a 12 pointer guaranteed every day. Stephen Bennett stepped up, but it was from play and from freeze. So Bennett, to me, was one of the main reasons Waterford got to that All-Ireland final through his leadership and his play. And he doesn't just tap the ball over anymore. He's the guy, he'll go for a goal if it's on. And he's number 14.
And then let's finish it off, Tommy. Who's in a corner forward?
So number 15, Desi Hutchinson. You know, the former Brighton player, the soccer player. We've seen what he could do with Ballygunner when he came on the scene in the last 2 years. Well, he backed that up this year. His performance against Clare was probably showcased the quality that maybe could lift Liam McCarthy Cup for Watford. You know, the goal here, he turned on a sixpence. He was just gone. Next minute, ball in the back of the net. The next one, he set up for Jack Fagan. It looked like he was being drowned out by the Clare defenders. And I don't know how he even see it. He must have eyes in the back of his head, straight across to Jack Fagan, and the ball buried. And the other goal then, you see Solskjaer, they used to play for Manchester United, Van Nistelrooy. These guys always in the right place at the right time. It's not all about, you know, running 100 yards. It's about using your head. Where is this ball going to land? So when that ball came across the goal, he was there standing, not in the square, right on the line, and just tapped the ball into the net. So, you know, Clare really could have caused an upset that day. And Desi, he, in the first game against Clare, he scored 3 points. He scored 2 points in most other games. I thought in the final, even though he didn't score a whole lot, the ball coming into the Watford full forward line was poor. And I thought he worked his socks off. He never stopped going and was always there out in front looking for the ball. So Desi Hutchinson to me, number 15.
It's a strong looking team, Tommy, I'm not going to lie. Nicky Quaid in goals, full back line of Sean Finn, Dahi Burke, Dan Morrissey. Half back line, Dermot Burns, Ty Duburka, Kyle Hayes, Keane Lynch and Tony Kelly in midfield. Garrod Hegarty, TJ Reid and Tom Morrissey is your man mountains of a half forward line. Aaron Gillan, Stephen Bennett and Desi Hutchinson complete the team. You are watching or listening to Tommy Walsh's Team of the Year. This is OTBAM and it's live in association with Gillette. Good morning, start with Gillette, giving you the confidence to tackle the day ahead. So you said your nominees so far for Hurler of the Year are Quaid, Tony Kelly, Garrod Hegarty. Was there a fourth nominee?
Yeah, no, it is Sean Three. Finn.
Sean Finn, sorry.
Sean Finn, yeah. Tony Kelly.
Mm-hmm.
Kyle Hayes. And Garrod Hegarty.
Sorry, right, okay. So Hayes, yeah, Kelly, Hegarty or Sean Finn. Which of those four will be crowned as Tommy Walsh's Hurler of the Year?
So, crowned, I narrowed it down to two. Kyle Hayes and Garrod Hegarty. The defender in me wanted to give it to Kyle Hayes.
sure he's a forward anyway.
He is a forward anyway. We never see the defenders, rarely see the defenders winning these awards. But listen, you can't look past a man that scores 7 points in an All-Ireland final, 4 points in an All-Ireland semi-final. The guy that was tipped for Hurler of the Year before the All-Ireland final. All the pressure on him. Everybody knows the way he plays the game. Everyone said there's a way of stopping him. Let's stop Garrod Hegarty and we'll stop Limerick, and they still couldn't do it. the man was, as you said a minute ago, a man mountain, and fully deservingly, I think, of hurler of the year. So Garrod Hegarty for me.
Absolutely. Great pick, Tommy. Tommy, thanks again. Happy Christmas to you. And your one prediction for 2021, are Kilkenny going to be back? They're the one team who look like they can beat Limerick.
Yeah, sure. Listen, I don't know. We hope, like, I can't see any retirements. It's going to go into a new year straight away. So yeah, they're in the All-Ireland semi-final. What was it? 9 or 10 pints up there at one stage. So yeah, I'll give them every chance.
All right, Tommy. Happy Christmas. Take care.
Thanks, Owen. Same to you.